I'm It's usually out on the elder night, so I guess that's what it is.
Yeah, it had been. It's better to do on different nights, I think. Okay, so that's all the announcements. We're gonna do our joys and concerns later as part. So it's nice to have David back tonight. Last time I saw him, he was getting married. And he got two of the cutest little grandkids. That was a good deal. Two adorable little grandkids. And just the sweetest they can be. And congratulations. Good to see you back. Let's bow for a moment in prayer. Our Father God, as we gather today for worship as your church, we pray your blessing be upon us. When you have promised where two or more are gathered in your name, there are you in our midst. We lift up your holy name this morning and come to be a part of your worldwide effort in the redemption of the whole world through your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we do pray. Amen. Grade had a little song book, and she was singing some of those little children's jingles. And I said, Jesus had a song book. And she said, oh, he did. Do you know any of his songs? And I said, yeah. And this just opened the Bible up to Psalm 24. I said, this was one of his favorites. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. And she said, can you sing that? And I said, no, I don't speak Hebrew. The world and all who live in it, for he founded it upon the seas and established it on the waters. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by a false god. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God their Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates, lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord mighty, he is the King of glory. Shall we stand together as we sing praises to the King of glory? Shall we stand?
Thank you.
many concerns. When we're trying to figure out a really good way, we're trying to figure out the best way to have joys and concerns in our prayer time together, so we can get on the video, so we can include people at home, and they can actually see when you give a prayer request. Your friends at home can see and hear it. And we're developing that. But right now, if we go down there and talk, they can't see it on the camera. So let's just do that from here. Harriet Lawrence was scheduled for surgery on July 7th. Bobby, what do we know?
She's home. She said she's doing good.
Wonderful one. She went into isolation before she went in, so we haven't seen her in a little while, but she's doing well. Cindy Witt is scheduled to see the pacemaker cardiologist on the 16th of July. Mark Blankenship fell on July 4th. He's at home. He broke his hip. He had surgery on the 5th, and he's doing okay. I think if he could get comfortable, he could rest pretty good, but it's really, really hard to do that.
John?
Yes?
He's at Richfield.
Hey, he's Richfield.
404.
I knew that. Yes. I knew that. Yep, he's at Richfield. I was looking at this next one. 7-month-old Soleil Harry. Now, Soleil is an unusual name. It's French for sunshine. Soleil. In Charlotte last week, had the granddaughter of Heather Burnett. She had surgery. She had a mass growing in her lung from the time she was in the womb. And they had to take that mass out. And the lung will regenerate and grow back. And everything looks like it's going to go real well. But the little one, that was pretty serious. Doctor said everything went well. Do we have any more concerns that we want to share together? Yes.
I want to ask God for all three of my children. Lynn Gables in the hospital, but we need prayers for Sandra and Wayne. And then my best friend's having surgery for hospital cancer, Wednesday.
We want to keep them in our minds as we go to the Lord in prayer. Let's bow in prayer together as we lift up our concerns. Our Father in heaven, as always, your people gather in prayer. We lift up those that are in dire need. We thank you for the healing that we've seen. We thank you for the success in surgery. We thank you for the doctors and the medicine that ease pain and start the healing process in a positive direction. We pray, our Father, that you be with those of our fellowship who are lifted up this day. For indeed, we need to feel your presence in difficult times, when fear and disease are upon us. It is your light and your comfort that brings us the peace that comes from your Holy Spirit. We pray, our Father, as we come out of this pandemic, that the world might find itself in its rightful mind. We pray that your word might increase, and that sin and greed and war might decrease. We know that you have called us to be a people of peace and graciousness. You've called us to be a people of joy and thanksgiving. Forgive us, our Father, when we are unaware and forgetful people, for you have created us, and we always need your forgiveness. We pray that you would forgive us and cleanse us and make us to be saved in the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray that your Spirit might fill our church and might fill our community, that we might be the people that you call us to be. Be with us, we pray. Be with those who call upon your name in times of sickness and distress. And hear us as we lift together that sacred prayer that your Son Jesus Christ taught each one of us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive others who sin against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen. Family dinner is one of the best times ever. I had a chance to eat dinner with some of my family this week, and it's just really nice to sit around the table with everybody and kind of look face to face as we share a meal. Unfortunately, all of us ate too much, and the meal was over. We were all going kind of dragging ourselves out.
Yeah.
The good thing about communion is you won't overeat, and you won't get too many calories. There's nothing here that's going to clog up your arteries, but it is in every way spiritually stimulating. You know, we come and we sit at the table with Jesus. He asks us to remember him, to reconfigure your presence at his table with himself and his disciples, having a family meal. That's what this really is. You're having a meal with the family of Jesus Christ, biggest family in the world. Having a family dinner, you can take this and you can sit at this table with this cup and this loaf, and you can remember every Christian that ever stood at this table, everyone you've ever met in the church as part of this family, your grandparents, your parents, all of your close friends, the people when you were little that you looked up to in the church. All these people gathered together for this same meal. Pretty awesome. I think if we tried to bring in a whole lot of food, it wouldn't work very well. This works nicely. As we prepare to come together for our family meal this morning, shall we look at our communion meal?
Thank you.
brilliance of communion. It is so very simple, but yet so very big and powerful. If we do what Jesus asks us to do, which is to receive the loaf, and as we hold it, remember him. And in our minds, if we remember him and we're sitting at the table with him and we're viewing him on Calvary's cross and we're seeing him walking on the water and we're seeing him heal the sick and we're seeing him raise the dead, and in your mind, if you're holding the loaf and you're remembering him, you're doing exactly what he told you to do. And the Bible tells us when we're obedient, we are blessed. If you'll take this little loaf out and hold it in your hand, as we've been instructed to do, I'd like to say a short blessing, shall we? Our Father God, we pray your blessing on this loaf, that it be to us the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, given for us. We're thankful that we can be obedient to his word, to come and remember him as we receive his gift. Put your blessing and your spirit upon this, we pray. Amen. And Jesus said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in memory of me." And if you will open the cup prepared in this small chalice, pretty serious when you give your blood for something. Jesus said, "This blood is a new covenant. It's a whole new agreement with God given in my blood. And I offer this to you, and as you do this, think about me." Shall we bow for the blessing of the cup? Our Father God, we would remember your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for each of us, who knows each of us by name, who waits to receive us, for he is the Alpha and the Omega. And in the end, it is this blood which saves each of us, for it is our new covenant for eternal life. We pray your blessing upon this cup now as we receive his gift through the power of your Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. And Jesus says, "Take this cup and do this in memory of me." And so it is that in his action, his sacrifice, he has sealed our future forever. As he said, the gates of hell cannot stop it. In his body and in his blood, he has saved us unto eternal life. This morning, as we prepare to go to hear a sermon, let's hear a musical sermon. Beautiful little sermon in this song. See if you can pick it out. Thank you. Now back in the 50s and 60s, there was a movie called The Ten Commandments. If you haven't seen it recently, I would encourage you to go back and get a copy and check it out. I think it will add tremendously to your understanding of the Old Testament. Charlton Heston does a great job of Moses, and it shows when God delivers the Ten Commandments. Now, listen to the context. This is the 20th chapter of Exodus. This is verse 18. This is just after he delivers the commandments, but this is what the environment was like when the Ten Commandments were delivered. When the people saw the thunder and lightning and heard the trumpet and saw the mountain covered in smoke, they trembled with fear. They stayed at a distance and said to Moses, "Speak to us yourself and we will listen, but do not have God speak to us or we will surely die." Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. God has come to test you, so that the fear of God will be with you to keep you from sinning." The people remained at a distance while Moses approached the thick darkness where God was. The Ten Commandments were delivered in fear and trembling, mountain covered in smoke and darkness. Thunder, lightning, trumpet sounds. People were scared to death. People take them pretty lightly. I saw recently it was billed as the Ten Suggestions of God. Well, when you read what I just read, that doesn't sound like a suggestion, does it? Sadly, people were scared to death when this was delivered. It was kind of like, when the sheriff comes up to you and puts some paperwork in your hand and you go, even before you open that letter, man, your heart's beating. That's kind of how this was. It was like God got their attention before he delivered his message. And the first of these commandments, I'm the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt. You were slaves. You were nobody. I brought you up. I built you up. I made you who you are. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven, on earth, beneath the earth, or the waters below. You shall not bow down and worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for sin of the parents, but showing love to a thousand generations to those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse my name, the name of the Lord your God. Remember the Sabbath to keep it holy. And then he goes on, honor your father and your mother. You shall not murder, commit adultery, or steal, bear false witness. You shall not covet your neighbor. That's the kind of community you want to live in. You go on vacation and come back and all your property is still there. Nobody can steal it or the whole community turns on. Living here in Salem, where the women are strong and the men are pretty, and all the children are above average. A wife may go away on a business trip and some other woman steal her husband. But no, God says you can't do that. If you go away, ladies, your husbands are safe. No matter how pretty they are, nobody's going to mess with them because thou shalt not commit adultery. People can't covet your stuff. If you get a new car, people are not going to turn jealous on you. Isn't that the kind of community you want to live in where your life is honored, your family is honored, your stuff is honored? People not going to murder you or the whole community turns on you? That's the kind of community I want to live in where murder doesn't happen. Murder, of course, the penalty for breaking it is pretty severe. You get stoned. You keep God's commandments, and in order for God to keep blessing the whole community, the community enforces the rules. somebody breaks one of the rules, the community is responsible to enforce it, or God punishes the whole community. Pretty good setup if you want to live in a good place. You don't need to live in a gated community if you follow the Ten Commandments, because stuff works out pretty good. Pretty scary stuff, though. God, the Hebrews, the chosen people, are slaves in Egypt. So God brings them out of Egypt, gets Moses to take them to this mountain. There, he shakes the mountain, covers it in darkness. You get clouds, you get thunder, lightning, scares the mess out of these guys, and then he gives them the Ten Commandments. These are your rules for getting along with each other. That's not bad. You know, these are your basic rules that we start with. That's where he started. And then it gets more and more and more. If you read Leviticus and you read some of the law books, they got a law for everything. You can only walk so many feet on a Sunday. There are ways that you have to cook your food. There are things you can eat, things you can't eat. It gets pretty silly. Got laws for everything. Too many laws. Can't even remember them all. But it's pretty severe. He is starting out with a brand new people. And he gives those Ten Commandments because that's the way he wants it to start. Now, there's a difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament. And the biggest difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament is the Messiah. Because the New Testament is the story about the Messiah's coming. Messiah is not in the Old Testament. They said, you know, he's coming, he's coming, he's coming. But the New Testament, from the beginning of Matthew, Mark, and John, the New Testament is telling us about the Messiah. There's a new sheriff coming to town, and he's going to be mighty and awesome. This guy, this new sheriff's going to save you from your sins. This is the Son of God, for God so loved the world that he's sending his Son. That's what the New Testament's all about. Trying to make clear that we know who the Messiah is. So he changes things. The Messiah gives us a new commandment. Remember that Monday, Thursday night, they're all sitting at the table. He says, love one another as I have loved you. He just finished washing their feet, for goodness sake. I don't think I've ever washed anybody's feet. Maybe my kid when he was little. You know, it's kind of a humbling thing. So instead of having the mountain and the smoke and the trumpets and all that fear, Jesus is sitting at the table and he says, new commandment I give you, new one. This is number 11. Love one another as I have loved you. Instead of that distance, it's closeness. Instead of that fear, it's love. And instead of that mystery, it's right in front of their very eyes. And then he gives them communion. What a change. We went from Mount Sinai to the communion table to receive a new commandment in the love and blood of Jesus Christ. Now this was before, I guess. Jesus is in the temple area, and the Sadducees, religious leaders, come up and they question Jesus. And Jesus puts them away. So the Pharisees, seeing that Jesus had outwitted the Sadducees, so they come up and give it a shot. And he outwits them. So finally, a lawyer, maybe their best guy, he comes up and he puts Jesus some questions. He says, what is the greatest and first commandment? Now, that's kind of like asking Babe Ruth how you hit a baseball, you know? Why in the world we would ask Jesus a question like that, but it's there for us to hear. And Jesus says, you know, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and your neighbor as yourself. Now look where we started with commandments. Thou shalt have no other gods before. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not murder. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor. That's where we started, but look where we end up. Look how far we've come. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, all your strength. Starts out defending your property and ends up God owns everything you got. Heart, mind, soul, and strength. Love God totally. Totally. Hebrew slaves weren't ready for that. Jesus says, love God totally. And in order to do that, you got to love your neighbor too, because God created him. He's your brother, God's son. Wow. Started out on Mount Sinai in thunder and lightning. We end up at the communion table with Jesus Christ and his disciples. Wow. Jesus washes their feet, tells them to love one another. I'm sacrificing myself for you. This is the new commandment I give my church, to love one another. There's a new sheriff in town. The New Testament tells us that God's promised Messiah is in our midst. And this is what he tells us to do. Of all the things, he could have told us what to do. Love God, heart, mind, soul, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. And if you do what Jesus says, it makes all the difference. Jesus, the New Testament says, Jesus, to the church, makes all the difference if we can keep him in the leadership position. You notice how sometimes we don't? If we can keep Jesus in the leadership position of the church, it makes all the difference in the world. Shall we pray? Our Father God, we're thankful for your word that comes to us, that we might indeed adjust ourselves, that we might recognize Jesus as your promised Messiah, the one you sent for our salvation. Help us to hear his voice. Help us to see his face. Help us to follow his commandments as together we live in your world and his church. In the power of your holy word, we pray. Amen. And as we think about all this, as we think about our responsibility, as we think about our response, as we think about loving God with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength, shall we stand for our parting?
Thank you.
Go in love, go with God. Shalom.
Go.